Let us stand now just a moment for prayer. We bow our heads. Our Heavenly Father, as we hear that beautiful hymn, we are thinking, Lord, that You're near. And we pray that You'll receive us tonight, Lord, as Your children, forgiving all of our sins and trespasses, and giving us of Thy blessings as we are needy people. And in this great hour that we're now living, and we see yearly, it gets darker and darker to the world, and the coming of the Lord gets brighter and brighter as He reveals Himself in His Word and in His manifestation. We have come again tonight, Lord, to attempt this meeting and to pray Thee to open to us, Lord, this third seal of this book, that it might be known to us, that we would know what to do and how to live and how to be better Christians. I pray, God, that You'll make every unchristian in here tonight realize their need of You. Grant it. And I pray, Heavenly Father, that every born-again Christian will realize that he must live closer than he has in the past, that we might all be in that unity of Christian love and faith. Grant that every sick person in our midst will be healed tonight, Lord. They do realize their need of You. And I pray, Father, that You'll bless everything that's done or said to Your honor and glory. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Well, again tonight, we've assembled together again for this, the Wednesday night of the week, and we're trusting the Lord tonight for a great outpouring of His blessings upon His Word. And today I have been studying, as usual, and trying to think of the things that would be more appropriate to say and how to say it, and then depending on the Lord to give to me the interpretation and meaning of this Word that's written. And I am grateful to Him for what He has done for us through the week of the opening of these seals. And perhaps it would be a good thing if Sunday morning, you know, many times we don't mean to be misunderstood, but, you know, it gets that way. And so maybe Sunday morning, if all who has a question in their mind concerning it would write it out and give it on the desk here Saturday night, and so I can see what it is, and then I try to answer for you Sunday morning, Lord. But I think that'd be better than what we were planning, because sometimes it's misunderstood, you know, and so that way it'd be better that I would get it straight, you know, be just what it should be. Because sometimes someone called today and said called up and wanted to know if it was true that when the rapture taking place, there'd only be one in Jeffersonville and one in New York and the rest of them overseas. So it just misunderstood. And then someone said that Saturday night, if the Lord give to us the last seal, then Jesus would be here Sunday morning. So you see, you don't, that isn't so. It isn't. We don't know. If anyone tells you that they know when He's coming, you know they're wrong to begin with, because no one knows that. But we want to live today like it was right now. I'm going to kind of turn you around for a minute, so be ready. I believe Jesus will come within less than 3 minutes from right now of His time. You know how long that would be? About 35 years. See, 1,000 years is only one day with Him. So when you hear the apostle back here said, the time is at hand, or the time is at hand. The apostle said that in Revelations. You know how long that's been? That was just yesterday to God. Not even 2 days yet. And see, if it's 3 minutes, less than 3 minutes of his coming, see, that'd be 30 years about to us or something on that order. And look how, what 3 minutes would be to him. He's already rising up to come. So we sometimes when you read here, he's speaking in the terms of the Word, see, not in our terms. And then if I knew he was coming tomorrow night, I would study and ask him to give me the message for the fourth seal. And I come down here preaching just the same. I want to be doing every day just what I would be doing if he comes. And I don't know no other better place than to be caught right at the post of duty. See?
Amen.
At the post of duty. So we just keep carrying on till he comes. Sometimes when we just read, and I be real careful, and when you get the tapes, listen to them real close, because you'll get it on the tape, because they've been playing them tapes back and they're really good and plain. So you'll get it clear there. Now, everybody in love with Christ, I hope, tonight, and everybody loving him. I tell you what, sometimes what confuses people, it's someone that come in and didn't get the first part of the service, you see. Then they come in and hear you refer back, hit back something, and then they take that what you said, they didn't get the first part, then it's all confusing to them, you see that? And they do think something was said different, but it isn't. So if you got a question that you don't understand, just write it on a piece of paper, lay it in any time between now and Saturday night. And I'll try Sunday morning to, if it's a little puzzling, you say, well, I wonder just what this meant here, I didn't get it. You know what I mean? Then I'll try to answer for you Sunday morning, the Lord willing. Now, tonight we're going to read from this blessed old word again in the sixth chapter. And we start tonight with the third seal. And that is the fifth verse, the fifth and sixth verse. And tomorrow night we close the four riders, the white horse, and red horse, black horse, and pale horse. And I want to say this, that each time, even till this morning, I get up real, real early and go to prayer before things stir, and just keep on praying through the day. But this morning early, the Holy Spirit came to where I was, and just as plain as anything, I've seen this other seal open up. Just exactly. He hears me, I know, and I'm very grateful. Now, you'll just remember that there is something happening, and I hope you're catching it. There's something happening. I just wanted to test this church one time and see if they could actually pick up something before it actually taking place. I remember what I've told you, and the Lord help us. Now, in the fifth verse, and when he had opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, come see. And I beheld, and lo, a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hand. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts saying, a measure of wheat for a penny, and three measures of barley for a penny, but see thou hurt not the oil and wine. Now, let's background this just a little bit on the seals that we have passed, because just like in the church ages, while we try to give a background to kind of lap it over, that's the way the ages are actually in the Scripture. One laps the other one over, just like that, like climbing a ladder. And climbing a step, rather, one running down to the other, coming back like that, it should go up a step. And now, this seals, the book of redemption sealed. Everybody understands that?
Amen.
And this book is sealed with seven seals. It is a seven-sealed book. And now remember, as we pictured it out to you and took it from Jeremiah, and all, now they wrote like this on a piece of a script or a paper, rather, or not paper, but it was a hide, and they rolled it up like this. Now that, and then the end of it was left like that. That denotes what's there. Then the next one takes the same kind of position, rolls up the same way, rolls like that, and then at the end here, it's torn off like that and left another one. Well, that was the seven sealed book. Now, we never had books like this till lately. The books in the old time were scrolls. They were rolled up. And then when they want the subject or anything like, if the Bible's rolled up, you want to read the book of Isaiah, you turn down here to Isaiah and unroll it like that and read it. And this is a seven sealed book of redemption. And now we find that the Lamb comes out, takes the book out of the hand of him that's set up on the throne, and breaks the seals, and looses the seals to the people. And the four beasts sitting there that we talk in the church ages, the same four beasts, you see them all the way through the scripture, and they are the one who does the announcing of these seals being broke. Now, and we see it is a book of redemption. Then we went back and got the kinsman redeemer and picked him up to see what his work was. And now, for all these years, Christ has been doing the kinsman redeemer work. Now, all that understands that, say amen.
Amen.
He has been doing the work of the kinsman redeemer. But there will come a time that when the redeeming work will be over. And when the redeeming work is over, then he leaves the throne of God where he's seated now. But that's not his throne. He that overcometh shall sit with me in my throne as I have overcome and sat down on my Father's throne. That's not his throne. That belongs to Spirit God. Christ the Lamb, it doesn't belong to him. He is the incarnate God, see, which is the same God made incarnate. Now, he rises from the seat. First, the announcement went forth for who is able to come and take this book of redemption. See? For the whole plan of redemption from Adam, all that Adam lost, there was nothing lost until Adam. And after Adam, all was lost. And the earth and everything on the creation of the earth was lost, and everything fell with Adam, crossed the chasm that no one could get back. No way at all. Man, when he sinned, he left his way, he left no way back for himself. And then, when this question was asked, John the Revelator, the prophet John, was in the vision and saw it, and there was no man in heaven, no man on earth, no man beneath the earth, or nobody was even worthy to look at the book. See? Now just think of that. Then the Lamb comes forward, and he takes the book. Now, John was asked not to weep anymore. He said, "Behold, the Lion of Judah has prevailed." And he can take the book and open it. So he turned to look for a lion, and he saw a lamb. The elder called, said, "A lion has prevailed." But when he come and looked, it was a lamb coming out from the throne. I had never noticed that before. Why? He had been back there, and he's doing his mentorial work, for he was bleeding for the people, intercessing for the people, until the last soul that was put on the Lamb's book of life before the foundation of the world come in. There's just going to be so many of them there, and that's it. That's all. The others won't even want to come in. They have no desire to come in. And so then, when that last soul comes in, then the time of redemption is finished. Then the Lamb comes forth to claim his rights to what he has redeemed. And that's all creation. The earth and everything belongs to him. See? He has redeemed it with his own blood. And when he come forth to take this book, to open it, why, my, John didn't weep anymore. And he looked, and this Lamb was a slain lamb. It was already been killed. But it was alive again. And now we found out that a slain lamb is a bloody lamb, bleeding all over. It's been slain. After being slain, it had raised again. It was sitting on the throne. Say, back in behind the throne like this, interceding for all those souls that would come. Then when the last one was here and it was completed, God still held the book of redemption. See? Now, he's just doing the kinsman work now, like Boaz went down and Ruth was just sitting there waiting until Boaz done the kinsman redeeming work. Remember me preaching that not long ago? Ruth gleaning and Ruth whatever she did and all down, and the last thing was Ruth waiting. Remember how I typed that in the church? While Boaz goes down to do the kinsman redeeming work. He did it. Kicked off his shoe and made a testimony and redeemed Naomi, and through there got Ruth. Now, so Ruth was just waiting because she'd already labored. She'd done all these other things, but she was waiting. Now, and then when the church is waiting, resting, most of them in the dust of the earth, while he's doing his kinsman redeem work. Now, the world's still going worse, and sin is heaping up, and sickness and trouble and death and sorrow. The godless man and godless women die right down, cancer eats them up and everything else. Well, they can't appropriate enough faith to reach out there and take a hold of it. Amen. Now, notice, but then after it was all over, after his interceding was done, he comes forth. Takes the book out of the hand of him, and then John and everything in heaven, and again, the souls on the altar begin screaming. We get that in the sixth seal again? And how they rejoiced, and they fell down, the elders, and poured out the prayers of saints, and the souls on the altar cried, "Worthy art you, because you have redeemed us to God, and we're going back to earth to live as kings and priests." Oh, there was a great... And John said, everybody in heaven, everything beneath the earth, and everything, you heard him praising God about it. Amen. John must have found his name on there, you know, all that time. Then he said he is worthy to take the book of redemption. Now, it doesn't belong back to the judge anymore. It belongs to the Redeemer. And he's done the work of redemption. Now he's going to show the church what he done. Amen. Amen. Then he just takes, but the book is closed. No one knowed it all. They know it was a book of redemption on it there, but it's to be revealed in the last days according to Revelation 10. The seventh angel is going to be given the message of that, because it said that in the time of the sounding of the seventh church age, the seventh angel, when he sounds, all the mysteries of God should be finished up by his sounding. Amen. Then after it's revealed, the angel come down from heaven, which was Christ. I remember this angel's on earth, a messenger. Amen. Down comes Christ, you see him in the 10th chapter of Revelation, puts one foot up on the land, the other on the sea, rainbow over his head, eyes and like feet like fire and so forth, raises up his hand, and swears by him that lives forever and ever on the throne that time shall be no more. And when he takes this oath, seven thunders utter their voices. And the writer, which when John was taken up, was supposed to write what he saw. He started to write down. He said, don't write it. Because, don't write that. It is he said, seal it up. What in? Seal up. Don't say it. See, it's to be revealed, but it's not even written in the Word. And then when he began to open the seals, we find out they were all puzzling. Amen. When he opened the first seal, he thought, now here it's going to say, and it will come that so-and-so will take the throne and certain do this and this will do that. But when it was, here just went a white horse riding and a rider on it. Well, he had a bow in his hand and he was given a crown after a while, he said. That's all. And the lamb turned back again and pulled another seal off, and here was a red horse rider. And he had given a sword, and he was going to make war and give him great power and take peace from the earth and kill one another. That was kind of still a mysterious thing, wasn't it, when he opened it up? And that goes on and said, in the day just before these seven thunders, all the mysteries here are revealed.
Amen.
Now look, then we find out, as we've been studying, that down through the ages, we've had reformers, not prophets.
Amen.
Reformers. And each office carries its own work. It's like a man that's a telephone operator, he isn't exactly an electrician. He might do a little job at it. And like if a man is a lineman, well, he's certainly, a man's a post hole digger and never did do any line work, he better keep off the line. But he might do a little patch up work or something. But when the real thing is to be revealed at the last day, of the last part of the church, is when God has said that he would send to us according to the scriptures, and we've searched it through and through, that he predicted that the spirit of Elijah would return in some person. Now, I think that's been made just as clear, and we're looking for that to happen somewhere, an anointed person in the last days to rise up. Now, you'll hear a lot of fanatics and everything else, but that just tries to, it's the devil trying to take away from the real one when he reaches in. But it'll be properly identified. You know what Elijah was, and watch that, and you'll know. And then when the elect will know.
Yes.
Not the others. They sure won't do it. They'll miss it a million miles. Like we've been through all that and showed how they missed John, how they missed Elijah, how they missed Jesus, how they missed them all the way along. And they'll do the same thing. Because the Bible said they would. So then, in that time, it'll be very humble. It'll be so simple, that'll want to make people fall away from it. It's too simple for them. We find out, and always when people get smart and educated and know a whole lot, then they that's just kind of misses it.
Yep.
Jesus never took them kind of people for be his disciples. He took unlearned people, fishermen, and nobody's connected with their churches and things. He just got ordinary men, tax collectors and farmers and fishers and so forth to do his work. Because they know they're nothing, then he can make something out of them. See? As long as they keep knowing that they're nothing, then God can work. But when they get to thinking they know something, then you don't know nothing that you ought to know the Bible. So then, we find that. And now we find out then that these mysteries are supposed to be revealed. And why didn't these other men, Wesley, Luther, and those great reformers who brought out justification, sanctification, the Pentecostal age with the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and why didn't they catch these messages? Why didn't they get them? Because they were reformers. See? It's like, take it on the other side, there was people come in who was had power as kings, but wasn't kings. See? You have to notice the Bible terminology of anything. See? Now, watch. But this, the reason that all the straying ends of the mysterious part about justification, the mysterious part of sanctification, the mysterious part of the baptism of the Holy Ghost, and why, what kind, did Eve eat an apple or did she eat a pomegranate or something, see? What was a serpent seed? And is the baptism in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Ghost, or the name of the Lord Jesus right? And hundreds of those things has been left loose-ended. See? And then in the last hour, this fella is to come on and reveal the thing.
Amen.
Take up the scriptures. You'll be properly identified.
Amen.
Yes, sir. And now it won't be a great big thing now. It looks like here in the Bible it'd be something big. How much bigger was it when John was supposed to come down there and baptize? Just think now, the prophets back all the way back, Isaiah, Malachi, and all of them spoke of him when he would come. And what he did, just a lone, old, uneducated feller with whiskers all over his face and hair sticking out like a fuzzy worm and a big old piece of sheepskin draped around him, no education at all, never went to school a day in his life as far as we know. Here he come out of the wilderness, not even as much as welcomed into a pulpit.
Amen.
And stood out there on the river of Jordan and began to call for people to repent.
Amen.
Could you imagine? The Bible said that everything will be so great in that day, even to all the high places will be made low.
Amen.
And all the low places will be brought up.
Amen.
Yes, sir. And all the rough places will be made plain.
Amen.
Well, I can imagine seeing them out there think John would come out of this great forerunner of Christ and just take all the desert and smooth it out and put it in grass again, see? Oh, I imagine they had it all fixed up like they have today.
Amen.
But it was so humble, even the apostles missed it.
Amen.
They said, well, why does the Scripture say, if the, you're going up there to be offered up now, why does the Scripture say that, that Elias must come first? He said, he's already come and you didn't know it.
Amen.
And Son of Man, they'll do the same thing. But John, he said, did just what was listed for him to do, and they done to him just what they're supposed to do. And says, so must the Son of Man be suffered. While there wasn't, I guess, one third of the whole Jewish race ever know that Jesus Christ was on earth. They might have heard of some fanatic down along there somewhere, but they didn't pay attention to what's going on.
Amen.
He came to his own, and his own received him not.
Amen.
Now there's where I believe, even, now it didn't say he'd secretly come, but the rapture will be a secret.
Amen.
Amen.
So if that was so secret when he come, how much more will the rapture be unknown? They want to directly say, well, I thought we're supposed to have a rapture and all this judgment up on the earth. He said, it's already taken place and you didn't know it. It'll be so, just like a thief at the night. Like a book I read, what is that called? Romeo and Juliet, is that what it was?
Amen.
Something, he let the, got the ladder upside down somewhere out for a long time ago. And come God, he's to get her out at nighttime. Now, that's the way that it'll take place. And it'll be gone. Not that they'll send a bunch of angels down with some spades and dig up the graves. The Bible said we'll be changed before even you could bat your eye, just a twinkle. It'll all be over.
Amen.
That quick. Just say somebody disappeared. Well, I'd imagine if we could search the world over, today there's been 500 people disappear off the earth each day.
Yeah.
They don't know nothing about them. They just come up disappearing. Well, there ain't going to be too many going that rapture.
Amen.
Now, I don't want to scare you, and I don't think it's that way, but I just want to tell you what he said. And you know it yourself. As it was in the days of Noah, wherein eight souls were saved by water.
Amen.
Eight souls out of the world be saved by water. What do you say? Oh my, there's no need of me trying. That shows you haven't got the kind of faith you need.
Amen.
If there's just going to go be one, that'll be me.
Amen.
Because I believe. That's what you want to believe. Be me. I want to live so close to him. Now I know he's going to take me when he comes. I believe it.
Amen.
So if everybody else misses, I'm going to be there by his grace, because he promised me that, and I know I'll be there. Because he can't lie, and I know my soul and life bears record. And I try to live daily just like he was coming. So I'm going to be that one. That's where you want to feel. If he's going to be eight, I'll be one of that eight.
Amen.
You'll be 500, I'm going to be one of that 500.
Amen.
Don't know about the other fellow, but I'm going to be one of that 500.
Amen.
See?
Amen.
That's the way you want to remember it. See? And if you don't remember it like that, there's something wrong with your faith.
Amen.
See? You're not sure you're saved yet then. You're just guessing at it. Do that. All right, we ain't going to get into the seal, are we? All right. I want each night, I don't know where you mind me taking up your time, we can get out a little bit earlier. There's not two in the revealing of these seals. Remember, it's only really one verse. The first tells the announcing of it. The second verse, most all commentaries and so forth, the reading of it are a reading of their thoughts. And I've always believed, like nearly all of them does, that first horse rider was the early church. But when the Holy Spirit revealed it, it was absolutely contrary to that. And so then all it does just show what it is. And then I try. Now to me, this is very sacred. That's the reason I'd rather answer these questions, and let's get everybody knowing straight and on tapes too, that they'll understand now. See, I tried to speak a while at night on backgrounding to get the people rushing in and pushing in, and you shouldn't do that. Okay? But when it does, it's human beings, and it's hot in here, and you and you restless, but you've been very, very nice. The best I've ever seen the people act in the tabernacle has been this meeting. And sitting quiet, and mothers take their babies to the nursery when they start crying, and everything has been very nice. But I've tried to background it until I just feel the anointing of the Spirit on me to say these words, to say what has been revealed to me. And then if I'm somewhere doing that, if I have made a mistake here, surely here before all the people, he'll correct it for me. I want it right. There's no need of taking just what you imagine. There's something right. And we want that. We want God to give us what's right. So now, we took these riders as they come up the first horse. Now, and we realize that was the Antichrist that went forth. And then we find out last night that the same fella that went forth as Antichrist as a white horse, we found him with a sword last night, riding and killing people. Now, it's always the natural and the spiritual, and for the church's sake, I want to type just before we get to the opening of this seal, which what he gave me, I got it wrote down here. I got several scriptures here, 7 or 8 pages of it. And as I refer to it, notice, I want to give a type of the church and make it so plain that you'll be bound to see it. See? Now, there was a natural bride in the Garden of Eden. Remember last night? That natural bride. She was Adam's sweetheart, not yet his wife, because he hadn't knew her yet as a wife. Just like Mary was Joseph's wife, but he never knew her yet. She was found with a child. See? Now, before Adam knew his wife, she was just a bride to him. Alright? And we find out that God, she fell in the Garden of Eden because she failed to hold to God's Word. Now, he knew that Satan would be loose among them, so he gave them a place to stay behind, fortify them. Well, who could know any better place to be fortified than God if he's trying to take care of his own children? If I want to take care of my little Joseph, a brother, everything, and I know his life depended on it, why, and I was able to do it, well, if 40-foot concrete reinforced would be the thing would do it, I'd make it 90-foot. To be sure that, and if I can think that about my little boy, which if his mortal life had lost, I believe a child would be saved, how much more to God, to his child that would be eternally lost? What should he place him behind? He placed him behind his own word. As long as you're in that word, you're safe. If you abide in me and my words in you, then just ask what you will. That's it, the word. So Eve got to strolling in the garden, and she run into the serpent, a very polished up sort of a fella, and he was on the other side. God lives, dwells, works in humility. Never any other way. Now, the little humble lady walking along there, and Satan come up as a wise, slick, polished sort of a fella, and he wanted to sell her the program as long as, no matter how much Satan was around, as long as she stayed behind this word, she was all right. Yeah. Amen. So let Satan do whatever he wants to. You just stay at the word. Amen. Don't make a bit of difference. If he says, well, you're sick, by his stripes I'm healed. Well, you're going to die, you'll raise me up again. They just stay behind the word, that's all. Christ retreated to the word himself. It's written. Now, stay behind the word. But Eve, she began to kind of let down. But she never let it all down. She only let one little phrase down. And that's what Satan wanted her to do. He got her from behind God's promise by reasoning. Don't never try to reason God's word. Just believe it. Amen. So She stepped out from there, and before Adam ever got to her for a wife, she was already defiled by Satan.
Amen.
And did you notice Christ did the same thing? Exactly. Now for redeeming, God had to be there first. And did you notice Mary, before she would come to Joseph, the Holy Spirit done got there. That's where the Redeemer comes. Now notice, the natural woman fell, and God made a way for her to be redeemed. Although she had fallen, He made a way. Now that was the first bride on earth fell before her husband and her were married. She fell by the reason of reasoning. Instead of staying with the Word, she fell. And she fell to death. Eternal separation. With her, she took her husband and everything else there was on the earth. She fell. Now, but God, full of mercy, made a way to redeem that woman. And now He promised her, telling her that sometime in the future, the true Word would come to her again. The true Word would be made known to her. I remember that, because He promised Christ through the woman. And Christ is the Word. St. John 1, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh.
Amen.
See? And dwelt with us. God dwelt with us in flesh. He was the Word. Before Word, it's a thought. And a thought has to be created. All right. So, God's thoughts become creation when it was spoke by a Word. That's when He presents it to you as a thought, is thought, and it's revealed to you. Then it's still a thought until you speak it. That's the reason Moses went out to pray, a pillar of fire around him, and he said, go hold your stick towards the east and say, call for flies. There's no flies. But he went and held the stick there and said, let there be flies. No flies at all, yeah. Went on back, but the words, God's thought has already been spoken. It's a Word. Now it's got to happen. Now, don't you see what Jesus said? If you say to this mountain, not if I say it, but you say to this mountain, be moved. And the first thing, I guess, in Moses' time, big old green fly began to buzz, and after a while, it was 5 pounds per yard. Where'd it come from? God created him. Don't you see? God can destroy this world tonight with gnats if He wants to. Well, He could pile gnats plumb to the moon. All they do is just say, let there be gnats to the moon. That'd be all there would be to it. No chemicals or nothing. They just keep on growing on. See, He can do what He wants to. He's God, the Creator. All they do is just speak it. That's right. He's the Creator. Now, if we just get to realizing how great He is, He just does what He wishes to. He sits up there and looks at people, and these little educators smarting out, and there's no God and everything. it's just like He was at Babel. Now, we notice that God told Eve that after so long a time, the Word's coming back to you. Now, how did she fall? I want my class to say it. What did she fall from? What did Eve fall from? The Word. Is that right?
Yeah.
The Word.
Right.
And God said He'd make a way to redeem her back to the Word again.
Yeah.
All right. After so long a time, the Word would be known to her. All right. The Word would come for one purpose. Now hold tight now what I'm saying. The Word would come to her for one purpose. That was for redemption. All right. But until then, she had a substitute that would work until the time arrived for the original Word. You understand clearly? See, He told her the Word would come to her again, but until that time, He gave her a substitute until that time arrived.
Amen.
So He gave her an offering to make, a substitute for that blood. Now, the blood was of bulls and sheep, goats and things, but it didn't take away her sin.
Amen.
See, it only covered her sin.
Amen.
It didn't take it away at all. It covered it. For it was an animal's blood, and in the animal's blood is animal life. It was a substitute until the real, get your coats on, the real human blood, as human beings would be, become incarnate.
Amen.
God.
Amen.
Without sex, virgin.
Amen.
The virgin birth produced that. Now, God's word, promise, became blood and was incarnated in the person of Jesus Christ the Savior. The blood of bulls and goats and so forth. But now wait, here God made the promise, saying it would be there when it comes. Her seed should bruise the serpent's head. Now, if her seed comes like from Adam, or like had been from the serpent and so forth, then it'd still be sinful seed. That's the reason John wept. There's no man, because nobody, everybody's crossed the other side of the ditch, the chasm. But there's coming a time that when this substitute blood of animal would be done away with, when the real incarnate blood came. God made flesh and blood. The Bible said he was. 1 Timothy 3:16. Without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness, for God was manifested in flesh.
Amen.
That's right. Virgin birth did this. Now the blood of sheep and goats covered sin, but didn't get rid of it. For it was the animal's blood, but it was to be all right, but to be a substitute, and they sure got used to that substitute. And so they just kept on. And when the real promised word was made manifest in Jesus Christ, who proved to be the Son of the great Creator God, and was vindicated himself by being the living Word of God.
Amen.
He proved he was.
Amen.
He could speak things into existence.
Amen.
There ain't a human being or nothing in the world can do. Ain't a thing on earth can create but God.
Amen.
The devil can't create.
Amen.
He's a perverter of what's been created, but he can't create.
Amen.
Sin is only righteousness perverted. You know what I mean?
Amen.
What is the lie? It's the truth misrepresented. See? What is an adultery? The right legal act perverted. Everything in sin is just the truth perverted. Now, he could not create, but when Christ came, proved he was the Creator.
Amen.
There was the blood that had been promised. Now, if you want to read that, let's just turn for a minute. We go take a time on this anyhow. Tonight, it makes me nervous. I think everybody wants to go home, you know.
Oh,
and
no.
So now let's get Acts 2. Thank you. And we'll just... Acts 2, and we'll find out whether this is right or not. Whether he was proved that he was God. Get Acts 2. Now let's get here at the 22nd verse. Peter speaking the day of Pentecost. Ye men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles, wonders, and signs which God did by him in the midst of you, as you yourselves also know. A man that was approved that it was God among you by the very things he'd done, proved that he was. Here's Peter standing at the Sanhedrin telling them. Nicodemus knows the same. He said, Rabbi, we all know that you are a teacher, comes from God, because no man can do these things, says he come from God.
Amen.
They know it. But why? Now what? Eve was promised this, but when that bride come on down and refused, when the real word came to her, so the woman refused to recognize the Hebrew bride. For she was the bride of God. He put her away in divorcement. Is that right?
Yeah.
She was a bride of God. You say, well, he was never married yet. That's right. But Joseph put Mary away before he was going to put Mary away before this marriage. See? He was engaged to her. And when he come, and the word that he promised, come for the wedding, he found her wrapped in her substitutes so bad that she wouldn't take the real promise that had been made, the Word, Christ. Maybe you don't get it. Right. Let me go over again. I want you to get this thing. She was promised the bride, Eve, to be a redeemer. A redeemer would be the Word. And when the Word came, made flesh, she rejected it. She was given substitutes. Now hold that substitute. Given substitutes to go on until the Redeemer come. And when the Redeemer comes, she wanted to continue with her substitute and rejected the true Word.
Amen.
That was the Hebrew bride. So did he by the second Eve bride, the mother of all spiritual living. See? Eve means the mother of all that's spirit, all that's living. Eve, mother of all that's living. Now, and when he came to the Hebrew bride, she was the mother of all that was living. But she rejected it. Natural Eve fell in Eden by listening to Satan's reasoning against God's Word. That's how she fell.
Amen.
All right, sir. She fell because she did that. Spiritual Eve. Now, that's the church, Christ, bride. She fell not in Eden, but in Rome.
Amen.
See? At the Nicaea Council, when she rejected that Pentecostal church that went down to Nicaea and listening to Romans' reasoning, instead of holding on to the Word, she fell and everything away from her died with her, around her.
Amen.
Now, just as natural Eve fell, spiritual Eve fell. God's bride fell in the garden. Christ's bride fell in Rome.
Amen.
See? Notice. By the same reasoning against God's Word, she also forfeited her rights of virtue to Satan, which we found in the breaking of these seals, that was Satan and still is Satan there.
Amen.
The Bible said it's the very seed of Satan.
Amen.
And as Eve forfeited her virtuous rights and give them over to Satan in the Garden of Eden, the church, the bride of Christ, did the same thing at Rome when they forfeited the Bible for their dogmas and reasoning.
Amen.
See how types? You just run those types, you're bound to come out, right? If my hand looks like, if I've never seen myself and I see my shadow coming, I'll know just about what I look like. See? But that's why, if you want to see what's coming, look what has been. For all the old things were shadows of things to come, the Bible said. All right. For she forfeited her virtuous word, the Word of God, when she sold the Bible and put a man in there that says that the church has rights to change anything they want to change. And they've done it. And the bride of Christ, the Pentecostal bride, sold out her virtue at Nicaea just as Eve sold her virtue to Satan in the Garden of Eden. Exactly. All right. God has promised this church, this Pentecostal church, knowing she would do it, like he did to Eve, God has promised the Pentecostal church. Do you believe that she sold her birthrights before her virtue when she left over there? Do you believe that?
Amen.
She sure she did.
Amen.
Then what good is a creed? Not based on this Bible.
Amen.
I want somebody to find what's called the Apostles' Creed or even one word of it in the Bible.
Amen.
That's a Catholic creed, not an Apostles' Creed. Read Acts 2:38, that's Apostles' Creed.
He's got it.
Now, that's what they used all the time anyhow. So if you see, so they sold out their birthrights. Not only that, Methodist, Baptist, Presbyterian, Pentecostals, the rest of them's done the same. She formed a denomination. Rome, what made her do that? She formed a denomination and put man at the head of it. And the Methodist, Baptist, Pentecostals, and everyone's done the same thing, put a group of men at the head of it.
Yes, sir.
No matter what God says, you got to do it the way they say do it.
Amen.
But what is it? It's nothing in the world but spiritual prostitution.
Amen.
Wrong type of woman. Yes, sir.
Amen.
Creeds. Lying creeds. Man-made. Then she became, when she did that, I'll prove this. She became a whore to God.
Amen.
You believe the Bible says that?
Amen.
Yes, sir. Her daughters has done the same.
Yes.
Now in Revelation 17, if you want to mark it down, John was taken in the Spirit and saw a great whore setting up on him. We read it last night, and there was the seven heels of exactly what she had done, and she had given the world her filthy fornications. Is that right?
Amen.
And all the kings of the earth committed fornications with her.
Amen.
Cheating, stealing, lying, paying for repentance and novenas and every other thing. Well, I remember she had daughters. Well, if she become a body under an organizational system, then the whole system's wrong.
Amen.
And if Eve, disobeying God, throwed everything into death that was under, and every church that organizes throws everything to death under.
That's right.
Exactly. The whole thing's gone.
Amen.
That's exactly according to the Word here. Read Revelation 17. And the Bible said that He would burn her with fire and all her children with her.
Amen.
Right.
Amen.
That means every organization system will burn with the whore.
Yes.
Now, that sounds flat. And I know you'll hear from it. I want to hear from it.
Amen.
Amen.
And that's right, old.
Amen.
The Bible said so that makes it right.
Amen.
She became a whore. You can read Revelations, the 17th chapter. What did she do? She committed fornications against her own husband.
Amen.
Well, you say, no, that's the Bible. The Word is God.
Amen.
And if you take one thing, would you want your wife kissing some other man? If she didn't do no more than that, you wouldn't want her doing it.
Amen.
She'd prove her untrueness. Whosoever shall take one word away from it or add one to it.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Christ holds His wife pure with the Word.
Amen.
That's the way she must be.
Amen.
Oh, nothing, not one tot or one jittle or anything or tittle will pass from that law of that book till it's all fulfilled.
Amen.
Jesus said both heavens and earth will pass away, but My word shall never pass.
Amen.
Don't put any private interpretation to it. He wants a pure, unadulterated, not even a flirt.
No.
I wouldn't want my wife flirting with some other man.
No.
And when you go to listen to any kind of reasons beyond that, you're listening, you're flirting with Satan.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Don't make it feel wrong. God wants you to stay unadulterated. Stay right there in that word.
Amen.
Stay right with it. All right. God promised to her, as He did to Eve in the Garden of Eden, to this last Eve here, which the Pentecostal church, the beginning of the church itself is the mother of all of the living people, because as long as they go in there, but you see, when they take up her sins, they die with her.
Amen.
Here comes a little fellow along, he say, I want to serve God. They say, well, here's what you do. Go down there and repent. All right? I'll do it. Glory to God. Go down there and repent. Now come join us. But there you are. I got it. That's right. Died right with it.
Amen.
And that's what this book is teaching, see?
Amen.
Not what I'm saying, because it says you're so. All right. Now, God has promised her, as He did Eve, He told Eve there would come a time that the Word would come back to her again. Now, you remember that?
Yeah.
What she lost from, it would be restored, because there's only one thing can restore, and that's the Word.
Amen.
Exactly. I said, shoot a gun. If you don't hit the target, find where it went off at.
Amen.
You got to come back there and start again. And if you go back, you go to Nicaea. That's where you start again, see? Go back with them organizations, with all that church. We've been seeing these seals just perfectly.
Yeah.
Always wanted all my life. Why I was so against the organizational systems. Not the people. No. The people are just like me or you or anybody else. But that system.
Yeah.
That denominational system. Now I see it right here. Never known it till now. And that's right. God promised the spiritual Eve, as same as He did the natural Eve, and again, the Word would be restored to her. In the last days, He would restore to the church to the original word again.
Amen.
I'll watch real close. I want you to be sure now. God promised Eve the time would come when the word would be restored by her seed.
Amen.
This word itself would become seed.
Amen.
And when they give her a substitute, she held that substitute. And when the word come to her, what'd she do? I don't want it.
Amen.
It was too humble. Didn't look right to her. Wasn't polished enough.
Amen.
A stable? Oh, my. A guy like that, not a day in school? Well, how could he say that? That's no Messiah. A guy like guys kick him around like that and then call it Messiah, let him put a rag around his face and hit him on the head, and he called himself a prophet, a real prophet, raised up after him. They didn't know prophets.
Amen.
Jesus said so. He said, if you'd have known the prophets, you'd know me. Now notice, but when the word came to her, the way, just exactly the way God said it would come, she had figured out some other way.
Amen.
I'm talking about the bride, the Jewish bride, the Hebrew bride. That was Eve to begin with. Now when it came out here, she didn't want it. She won't stay with her substitutes. Now God promised spiritual Eve at Pentecost. Told it even before it happened, 400 years before the church ever fell, that they would fall away.
Amen.
And they would do what they've done.
Amen.
But he promised in the last days he'd send the word again.
Amen.
Jesus spoke the same thing when he was on earth.
Amen.
He was sent it again. And what will it find? It'll find the same thing that it found when it come first.
Amen.
Right. They want their substitutes. They want their denomination.
Amen.
They want their creeds.
Amen.
They want to live this way they want to. And they want, well, I'm so-and-so. I belong to so-and-so. Don't make any difference what God's doing, how much he manifests himself. He could raise the dead. He could tell the secrets of the hearts. He could do everything as the Bible said he would do. That don't make a bit of difference. If it ain't connected with my organization, it is nothing to it.
Amen.
Same thing that Hebrew
bride
did. That's right. They listened to their substitute, and God promised them the real.
Amen.
And when the real come, they didn't want it. It was too humble.
Amen.
That's the same thing today.
Yes.
When it rises on the scene, now God said in Malachi 4 that he would send the message in the last days that would restore.
Amen.
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 Joel said, I will restore
Amen.
All the ears.
Amen.
Everything that Rome eat up, everything
Amen.
The Methodist eat up, everything the Baptist eat up,
Amen.
Over that original Pentecostal branch, God said, I
Amen.
Will restore
Amen.
Him.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
And he can send us such a person that will be the only thing that God ever sent his word to as a prophet.
Yeah.
Not to reformers, to prophets.
Amen.
It wasn't the hour for it. Now it's getting to be the hour, and that's the reason we're watching for it to come.
Amen.
It'll be so humble and gentle, and so, oh my, you think them aristocratic Methodist, Baptist, and Presbyterian Pentecostals will ever receive it? Oh, you said Pentecostals? The Pentecostals is the lady of sins.
Yes, sir.
Rich and have need of nothing.
Yes.
It said you don't know that you're poor. Might be building millions of dollars buildings, but you're still poor.
Yes.
Spiritual poor.
Yes.
Oh, you say, I see it all. You're blind.
Yes.
Well, you say, bless God, I'm covered. Naked.
Yes.
Well, I sure are, boys. We got seminaries. And don't know it. Now that's just vice versa. Now if the Bible said that the Laodicean church would be in that condition, and there's no person on earth could deny that this is the last age, because the Laodicean church age was the seventh church age, and here we are. The second 2,000 years is finishing. There's no more church ages. That's the reason you latter rain brother couldn't start another organization. He's going to be tomorrow.
Amen.
That's right. It's at the end.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
There ain't been no more church ages. It's all over.
Amen.
But then if the Pentecostal message was the last message which justification, sanctification, the baptism of the Holy Ghost, the last three messages, the last three church ages, forms a complete birth. It's like when a woman is going to have her baby, the actual first thing happens is water, next thing's blood, next thing's life. When they killed Jesus at the cross, the substance come from his body to make up the birth. They stuck his side, blood and water came out, and into thy hands I command my spirit.
Amen.
What came from his body was water, blood, spirit.
Amen.
1 John 5:7 tells you about that. There are three that bear record in heaven: the Father, the Word, which is Christ, and the Holy Ghost. And these three agree in one. They're not one, but they agree in one. And there are three that bear record, or they are one, I mean.
Amen.
I'm mistaken. And the three that bear record in earth is the water, blood, and spirit. And they agree in one.
Amen.
You can be sanctified without being justified. You can be justified without being sanctified. You can be sanctified without receiving the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Exactly. The disciples in John 17:17 were sanctified and given power to cast out devils. Still didn't have the Holy Ghost.
Sure.
Had to go up to Pentecost and wait till the Holy Ghost comes. That's where Judas showed his colors. See how that Spirit worked its way through justification and sanctification? But when it come to the end, he showed his colors. That's right. Now notice. Now, here we are at the end time. And spiritual Eve, just as Hebrew Eve was promised, the Hebrew bride was promised the Word to return. And the spiritual bride from Pentecost, when she fell at Nicaea, then she's promised in the last days that the Word will come again. Now you say, go into the Scripture, take over here, Revelation 10. It said, in the hour, the time of the last angel, the seventh angel, seventh messenger,
Amen.
Begins to sound, the mystery of God is finished.
Amen.
The restoration back to the Word.
Amen.
The Bible said that the messenger of the last days would be restore them back to the original faith again.
Amen.
Back to the faith of the fathers. But you think they receive it? No, sir. Last days, he would restore the original word again. It said in Malachi 4, but she had forfeited. Now, she forfeited that word at Nicaea. Eve forfeited it in Eden.
Amen.
Eve rejected hers at Calvary. And Nicaea's group is rejecting it in the last days. It's the same. My. But when the Word came in human flesh, she, Eve, the Hebrew church, mother of all spiritual living at then, she rejected it. She was so dead in her traditions and dogmas that she missed it. So is this one. Exactly. All right. They miss him, the living Word, manifested in the flesh by the Word that is promised.
Amen.
The Word promised to do these things.
Amen.
The promise was made that it'll be like this in the last days.
Amen.
As it was in the days of Sodom, so shall it be in the coming of the Son of Man.
Amen.
Now watch what happened to Sodom. As it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the coming of the Son of Man.
Amen.
Watch what happened then. See? Now I said it'd be the same thing, and we live in that day.
Amen.
Well, there could be, I guess I could get 600 promises of them like that out of the Scripture, just referring to it. See? Now, but they rejected it. She held to her additions and substitute instead of she held to the substitute blood instead of the real blood. Jesus, the Word, said, when it was manifested to her, because she held to these traditions, Jesus, the manifested Word, said to the bride, Hebrew bride, because you hold to your traditions, you make the Word of God without any effect to you.
Amen.
It can't be effective. Now that's what's the reason today that the revivals that we're supposed to have, we have denominational revivals, we haven't had a real stirring. No. Oh, sir.
Don't think we got revivals.
No. We haven't. Oh, they've got millions and millions and millions of church members, but not a revival, no, sir.
Amen.
No. Now, the bride hasn't had a revival yet. There's been no revival there, no manifestation of God to stir the bride yet, see. We're looking for it.
Amen.
It'll take those seven unknown thunders back there to wake her up, I guess. He'll send it. He promised it. Now, why? Now, she was dead. And now, if the churches would forget their creeds and forget their dogmas and just take the Bible, plead the promise, then it would come effective to them. But see, Jesus said, you with your traditions make the Word of God not effective to you. Well, that's the same thing today with spiritual Eve. See? The spiritual bride of today, so-called the church, she takes the Word of God and she won't accept it and she accepts dogmas instead. Therefore, the Word's not effective to her.
Amen.
Because she tries to inject her creed with the Word.
Amen.
And it won't work.
Amen.
Now, what we need today, just keep reading this here, Herald of His Coming. Across the headlines, we need a prophet to return. We need a prophet to return. And I guess when he does return, they'll know nothing about it. That's right. It's always been that way, you see. We need it. Everything you talk about, we need a prophet to return who will bring the word of the Lord. Fearless. We be the Bible promising. I know Brother Moore and him eating his house and everything else. The editor, and he's the finest man, walks in shoe leather, I guess, one of the finest fellows. But see, he knows that we've got to have that. And Sister Moore, one of the finest women, little poor little fellow, and they sacrifice, and that's one of the best papers on the field, in my opinion, is the Herald of His Coming. But you find out, they keep blasting at, we need a prophet. We need a prophet. See? My, that's what they talk about. And then, here we are today, and like yesterday and today, announcing on the radio that in the Baptist churches and so forth, that we're not to take in with the Catholics, but we're to kind of fellowship with them.
Oh, yeah.
See? And right here, the message going out right here to stay away from that poison.
Yeah. Yeah.
How can two walk together unless they be agreed?
Yeah.
Light and dark can fellowship together. When light comes in, dark goes out.
Yeah.
Okay, the most powerful. You can't put light out with dark, but you can put dark out with light.
Amen.
That's right. And He is the light and He is the Word.
Amen.
There you are. Right straight back. You can't make it lie or do anything wrong. It comes right straight back to the spot again. Yes, sir. Just like some guys start trying to fuss with you. If you know where to stand, know what he believes, it's just like taking a rabbit and turning loose in a pen, and you got every hole stopped up. You stand at the gate. He's got to come back. He has come right back to the gate again because that's all we can get out. He'll stick his head through here and almost break his neck, go over there and over there, just stand watching. And he'll come right back. That's all. That's the only way you stay with that word. You can blast all around your creed, just break your neck everywhere, but you got to come right back to this word. It's always. Now, see, they don't want it. They don't want God's word. Because she held her traditions, she kept the Word of God from being of non-effect. The same now on spiritual Eve. She wants to keep her traditions and get away from the Word of God. She holds again to the denominations and her creeds and traditions of her elders instead of taking the Word of God. And when the promise of the Word in the last days is brought to her, she will not receive it because with her traditions, like the Hebrew bride did, the real word, though manifested, proven,
amen,
vindicated,
amen,
she won't have it.
Amen.
Why won't she? Because there's her time.
Amen.
She can't do it.
Amen.
Right. She can't beat her type. See? It's predicted she'd do it. So how are you going to keep from anything? Now the only thing you do is just be happy you're in. That's all. All right. God promised in the last days that He would manifest and would vindicate His word to her. And still she wouldn't do it. All that God promised
her by his servants the prophets. God promised through Jesus Christ. God promised through Joel. God promised through Paul. God promised through Malachi. John. God promised through John the Revelator. All them prophets just did exactly what the last message would be to her.
Now, if you'll write them down, of course you all know them. Jesus, John 14, 12. And Joel 2, 38. Paul, 2 Timothy 3. Malachi, 4th chapter. And John the Revelator, Revelations 10, 17. 1 to 17. See? Exactly what would take place now.
Amen.
And to the church, what is it? The incarnate Word made flesh amongst his people again.
Amen. Amen.
And they just don't believe it.
Amen.
You know what Jesus said when he done them miracles before them and proved that he was God? Proved that what he was doing, he had done exactly. He said to them, he said, "Oh, you Capernaum, who is exalted into heaven, if the works have been, the mighty works have been done in Sodom, that's been done in you, would be standing today."
Amen.
That's right. And in Capernaum, he never done nothing but heal a few people and told them the secrets of their hearts and walked out. That's all. See, they don't know what mighty works are.
Amen.
They think it has to be a great big program where everybody gets up and the judge makes a speech and the band's playing, the colors flying, and the well-dressed women tarrying, and all the PhD, LLDs, the big tall hats and turned around collars and everything, you all have to walk in. That's something great. God says that's foolish.
Amen.
And he brings up a little something. I don't know what difference between maybe ABCs hardly, and perform something that just sets the real church afire, and the rest of them says a bunch of holy rollers. God calls that great, and the world calls it foolish.
Amen.
The world calls that great, God calls that foolish.
It's
just vice versa.
Amen.
And the thing that God has promised, God will and has done.
Amen.
Here we are. Now, still she remains as she did the Hebrew Eve. She just wouldn't do it. You could raise up the dead. You could see the Spirit of God. Jesus came down, vindicated himself to be the Son of God. First he started preaching. Well, they thought, well, kind of odd-like fella. Who is he anyhow? Well, the first thing you know people are going to say, of course they said before when his forerunner come, John, they said, "Are you the Messiah?" I said, "Nope." But he's standing among you somewhere. See?
Yeah.
Why? He knowed when his message taken place. What he was to do.
Amen.
He knowed what he was going to do. Just like Noah kept watching Enoch. When Enoch went, Noah said, "Better get close to the ark. The time is at hand." Noah kept watching Enoch. See? And John watched for the sign that Jesus told him, or God told him to watch. He said, "He's standing right here now, somewhere among you. I don't know him, but I will know him."
Amen.
Stand there, they said, "Well, aren't you the Messiah?" I said, "We were sent from the headquarters." Said, "The elders and all sent us down here. If you're the Messiah, why don't you come up and make yourself known up there, not down here in this bunch of stuff down here."
Amen.
"You come up there and make yourself known." He said, "I'm not the Messiah." He said, "I'm the voice of one crying in the wilderness."
Amen.
That way as far as their head as they could go. They didn't know nothing about it. See? And yet they're all looking for him to come. But it couldn't be a guy like that. Oh my, that would be terrible. "What school are you from?" "None." "Have you got your fellowship card?" "What is it?" He was anointed of God.
Amen.
He said, "It's one thing I have, the axe is laid to the root of the tree." Now, That's all he had. He talked in terms of a woodsman, not the terms of a clergyman. Vipers and axes and trees and so forth. He didn't talk in ecclesiastical terms. But Jesus said there never was a prophet like him. Never a man born of a woman like him until his day. That's right. He was more than a prophet. He was a messenger of the covenant. Stood right between the two dispensations coming in. See? More than a prophet. And so then they didn't know him. They didn't understand him. He was kind of an odd-like sort of fellow. So they dismissed him, see? And When Jesus come then, and sure they wasn't going to accept him, this carpenter's boy, there was nothing like that. With a black name behind him of illegitimate, even they wouldn't go see a fellow like that. But look what God did. He took the unlearned, poor fishermen, woodsmen, farmers, and harlots.
Amen.
And left the dignitaries sit there.
Amen.
Why? What? Why did he do it? Why did he do such a thing? Could you imagine? Because that them people recognize him to be the Word.
Amen.
Now let's just watch him just a minute. Here's an old ignorant fisherman. Can't write his name. The Bible said he was ignorant and unlearned. He brings his fish up and sets it down. Goes down there and sees what all this noise is about. But way down deep in him, he knew that the Bible said that the Messiah, all Hebrews look for the Messiah. Because there was to be a scriptural thing happen when he comes. There'd been a lot of Messiahs raised up, said, I'm he, and let him off for the hundreds and perish and everything. But see, that was to throw off the real one when it comes. We've had Elijah's mantles and coats and every other thing, but that's just to throw off the real thing when he does come. That's right. All kinds of people that's wore the robes and the garments and been buried in all kinds of hoods turned around and everything else. That just only vindicates like a bogus dollar. It shows there's a good one somewhere if he can find it. So here he comes. Now, these dignitaries come out and they were so on their substitute. Well, they said, now, if the Messiah comes, he'll certainly come to Caiaphas's, he'll come to our denomination, he'll come to the Pharisees, the Sadducees. That's what you think, he'll come to the Sadducees. And there they was. See, the same thing they have today.
Yeah.
Now, but when he come, it was strange. He would come, very contrary to what they thought, but he come according to the Word.
Amen.
And they didn't know the Word.
Amen.
Let me say that real, so it'll sink way down. I want this to get it. That's what's the matter with you today.
Amen.
Amen. You don't know the Word.
Amen.
Jesus said you can discern the face of the skies, but the signs of time you can't discern.
Amen.
Said we, Moses, so said, if you'd known Moses, you'd know me. Didn't know Moses, and therefore they didn't know. They just know a creed that they'd hatched down.
Amen.
Now, let's take this old fisherman. Sets his basket down, puts his gray beard down, walks down people, see who it is. Brother said, come on, let's go down here. That's that same guy. I said, God, they said the other day, I stayed all night with him last night. You know, John, I was talking about, yeah, that wild man down there. Yeah, I heard about him. Well, old Simon, he said, I heard about him down there. Yeah, it's been that's 2 or 3 months ago down there. Yeah. Well, he said, and one day he was standing there, he said an odd thing. He said, you know, here he comes right now. They said, how do you know? It looked to her, it's an ordinary fellow standing there. He said, I see the Spirit of God like a dove coming down.
Amen.
I hear a voice saying, this is him.
Amen.
This is my beloved Son, in whom I am pleased to dwell in.
Amen.
Then he walked out in the water and baptized him, and so forth. Well, there, he said he knew him. Oh, I don't know, Simon said, I've heard all that lots of times. Here he comes up, but down in his heart was a predestinated seed.
Amen.
Jesus said so.
Amen.
Right.
Amen.
Walks up to him, walks up, so I'll go down to the meeting and see. Walks up there. Jesus standing there, just an ordinary little fellow. Walked up and said, why, your name is Simon.
Amen.
And your father's name is Jonas. That deflated him. Wow! That little eternal life seed struck in there. Yes, sir. So, wait a minute! How's that? You never did see me. Neither did you know my dad because he'd been dead for years. But here you come tell me that? Now, I know that the Bible says. Now, I have to now go back to what the elder says. But the Bible said that the Messiah would be a prophet. There he is. That's him. One day he passed through Samaria, going down through there with a bunch of Jews. He left them. This little ill-famed woman come out, maybe a pretty little lady, you know, and she'd been turned out on the street as a kid, and she was going through there. Maybe she was thinking about something. She walked up there to set the bucket down, and she started to let the window down, you know, get the water. She heard a man say, bring me a drink. She looked around there, said, kind of a middle-aged Jew. She said, say, aren't you a Jew? You shouldn't do that. It's not customary for you to talk to me. I'm a Samaritan.
said, but if you know who you're talking to, you'd ask me to give you a drink.
He said, where's your bucket? Where's your stream? Well, he said, the water that I give is life. But what?
Why, she said, you all want to worship in Jerusalem. Our fathers worship.
Well, I said, that's right. But said, we Jews know what we worship. But said, you know, the time's coming when man will not worship in Jerusalem or in this mountain. He said, they're going to worship God in the Spirit because He is a Spirit. Spirit and truth.
Well, she began to study, you know.
He said, go get your husband and come here. She said, my husband? I haven't got any husband. I said, that's the truth. Said, you've been running around with five, got the sixth one now. And said, you've had five, and you told the truth. Watch. What was it? That light. Amen. Struck that seed that had been laying there.
Amen.
That was spoke by God.
Amen.
Yes, sir. The seed was on the earth. When God moved the water away and the sun hit it, it come up.
Amen.
That's all it needed was sun. It needed light. Yes, sir. And then, when the Holy Spirit in him moved away her past life, showed it to her. That light struck it. She said, sir, I perceive you're a prophet. She said, I know it, that when Messiah comes, that's what he's going to be, and we ain't had a prophet for hundreds of years. We have never had a true prophet for hundreds of years. And she said, you tell me about my husband and told me how many have had and so forth. Well, I said, I don't understand this, that when Messiah cometh, well, he's going to do that, but who are you?
He said, I'm he. That was it.
A harlot. And the priest looked around and said, well, they have to answer to the congregation. They said, don't fool that fella. He's possessed of a devil.
Yeah.
That's the difference. That's the same thing today. Same thing today. It's just exactly. Yep. Yes, sir. She knew it because the light struck it. Them fishermen, woodsmen, farmers, tax collectors, harlots, they seen in him what the simple scripture said he would do.
Amen.
And the Pharisees couldn't see because of their tradition.
Amen.
They couldn't see because of their tradition, but the prostitute, the farmers, and all them, they saw it. All that was predestinated. When the doubts rolled away, the seed went to growing. That's right. What did she do? She said, well, I'm glad I met the Messiah. Oh, no, brother. Right into the city she went. She forgot about the water. She said, come see a man who told me the things that I've done. Isn't this the very thing that the scripture says Messiah's going to do? Isn't this exactly that? And the people could see that same thing as Jesus Christ said in St. John 14, 12. It would happen again. He said it also in Luke when he said as it was in the days of Noah, how God manifested himself in a man and told who was behind him and what Sarah did laughing in the tent. And all these scriptures of Malachi and so forth predicted in the last days.
Amen.
Hebrews 4
Amen.
Said when the word comes back.
Amen.
Malachi 4 said it would return back.
Amen.
Amen. The Hebrews 4 said the word of God discerns
Amen.
The thoughts that's in the heart.
Amen.
And they can see it done and walk right away from it. Their traditions hide it and makes it non-effect.
Amen.
Well, we're just here, that's all.
Amen.
You know, he could do the same thing today. He'd come out on the scene and produce the same things he did then as he said he would. See, he promised to do it. He promised to do it. And if he would do the same thing, the Laodicea messenger is supposed to do it.
Amen.
And then if the Laodicea church sees it done, they'll do just exactly like the Hebrew church did again. No matter how well vindicated it is, oh, it'd do it anyhow. Oh, my.
It says that we would return to the original word and be made manifested, his promise, to restore again the faith, original faith again. And if he made himself known that he was dwelling amongst his people by doing these things, he could even have his picture taken.
Amen.
Scientifically prove it.
Amen.
And still they don't believe it. Because let the mechanical eye of the camera catch him standing there. That same pillar of fire, same yesterday, today, and forever. Hebrews 13:8. To show that it's scientific in every other way.
Amen.
Scientifically, in the spiritual realms, in every way it could be vindicated, it's been vindicated. And you know, they'd probably do the same thing.
Amen.
They'd probably just walk right away and do the same thing as they did. Oh, God help us. We'll just stop here. God help us to see now, my prayer, as we come now, because I don't want to keep you too late. God help us to see. I believe maybe the Spirit upon us to be right now, that he'd help us to reveal, open up this seal. Let's read. As we see the state the church is in, we see where it has been, seen what they did, seen where it was supposed to come, see it there, and see what they're supposed to do. They did just that. Now, you see where we're at? You do the judging. I can't judge. I'm just responsible for bringing this word. Just as it's given to me, I can give it. Until it's given to me, I can't give it. No one else can. And when he had opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, "Come and see." And I beheld, and lo, a black horse. And he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hand. And I heard the voice in the midst of the four beasts saying, "A measure of wheat for a penny, and three measures of barley for a penny, but see thou hurt not the oil and wine." Now, the Lamb's got the book in his hand, breaking the seals. Broke the first one, second one, now he breaks the third one. And as he breaks it, the Lamb breaks it, the third seal, the third beast. Now, how many knows what the third beast looked like? Looked like a man. The first one looked like a lion. The other one looked like a calf or an ox. And the third one looked like a man.
Amen.
It was a man. And he heard the living creature, the beast, living creature like a man, said to John, "Come see what it is." This mystery, it's been hid all down through the years of redemption since the foundation of the world. It's been hid under this seal. What's going to happen? Now, come look what it is. And so he opens it up, a thunder blast, and the Lamb opens the seals. Now, and John walked up to see what it would be. What did he see? He seen a black horse, and his rider had a balance or scales in his hand. Now, that's the first thing he saw. When the Lamb announced it, it broke the seal, then the other beasts are taking a turn about announcing, "Come see." And John, where he was standing, maybe like this, he walks over here, when his Lamb opened, walks where usually the thunder strikes as we've seen the first seal, and he watches to see what takes place, and he sees a man coming first on a white horse. He watches him ride down. And on down to, John sees him come to the end. He sees him come down, he's white horse, got a bow in his hand, and the rider has, and he has no arrows with it. The next thing he sees, he gets a crown, rides right on through. Then we find out, then the Lamb, here comes again. He opens another one and looks. Now here comes a red horse. This man has a sword in his hand. He rides right on down through the scripture. See, this sword in his hand. And was to kill and take peace from the earth. Now the Lamb opens another seal. Another one of the living creatures like a man. Say, "Come see." Now he walks up to see what this is. And when he does, there comes a rider on a black horse. Now last night we found out that the same rider that rode the white horse was the same one on the red one.
Amen.
And the voice said, in the midst of the beast, called out, you see, to come to see what it was. He was in this living creature, and he saw this black horse. And when the voice in the midst of the four beasts called out, "A measure of wheat for a penny, and and three measures of barley for a penny, but seest thou hurt not the oil and the wine. See? This writer, let's discuss him. If you notice, the first writer, who he was, and we found out last night scripturally that the second writer was exactly the same man, only he is on another horse. What happened? He changed his ministry. See? Right. We found out he was an antichrist. And he changed his position. We found out that when he first just was a white horse, he would come a doctrine. Now we've taken every one of these right back in the scriptures. Okay? Now watch where we're at tonight, that other church age now. Okay? We're coming down to the third church age now. Okay? Just exactly on the third church age is just exactly like the third horse. Okay? Now the first church age, why what? The Nicolaitans had a doctrine. See, this is the first one. Alright? And then the first thing we know, this Nicolaitan doctrine, it becomes sanctioned and was right. Went into action. And it crowned this fella. Then this spirit, Antichrist, become incarnate in a man. See? And we find out later on he becomes an incarnate devil too. The demon goes away and the devil comes in. And just as that church is, that kind of Antichrist church progresses, so has the bride come along.
Amen.
With different things too. Justification, sanctification, baptism, the Holy Ghost is moving right on. See? Just like only they've taken their revival first, and the church is taking it at last. Their first 3 years, the first three stages of them, it went through the dark age, then the third three stages comes the church out. From justification, sanctification, baptism, the Holy Ghost in. Incarnate God made manifest among us. Here he comes in as the Antichrist, as the false prophet, then the beast, then the dark age. And the church comes out of that dark age, justification, sanctification, baptism, the Holy Ghost, incarnate word, go in.
Amen.
And he goes down.
Amen.
He goes down, the church goes up. It's just as perfect as it can be. Oh, it's beautiful. I just love it. This writer is the same one, but another stage of his ministry. The first stage, a white horse, see? He was just a teacher, just an antichrist teacher. He was against the word of God. Now, how can you be an antichrist? Anybody that denies that every word of this isn't true to be taught just the same as an antichrist. Because they deny the word. And he is the word. Now, first stage, white horse, he was just a teacher, but an antichrist spirit in its doctrine and its quality. It was innocent. It couldn't hurt nothing. See, Mike, just going on. That's why Satan comes in. Oh, he's a slick bird. They told him, he said, now, you know, you're looking for wisdom. You don't know what's right and wrong. So now, if your eyes were open, you would know what. And said, the fruit is very pleasant.
Yeah.
It's good. It's pleasant to the eye. You should take it. Now, you don't know what it is or not, do you? No, I don't. But God said not to do it. But, oh, well, I know, but God said he would die. He said, surely you won't do that. As sweet as it could be, look what it did. Watch this Antichrist spirit rise up amongst the early church. A doctrine of Nicolaitans. Nico, conquer the laity, make a holy man. Or just, well, we just want fellowship. While you're scattered out here, nobody knows where nobody's at. I think we all ought to have an organization and just be different. See? We've got to have, put ourselves together. We ought to make a lodge out of it. And that's what it is.
Amen.
There is no such thing as the Christian church. Of Methodist, that's not a church, that's a lodge.
Amen.
Baptist, that's not a church. It's a lodge. There's only one church. That's the mystical body of Jesus Christ, and you're born into that.
Amen.
That's right. By predestination. That's right. All the Father has given me will come. No man can come unless the Father calls him. And all he's given me will come to me. So that's it. He just, the Lamb sits there making intercession until the last one comes in. The little bell rings and he walks out and takes his possession. In, see? So brings his church home, his subjects, and casts his enemy into the lake of fire, and all of his subjects go in there with him, and that's it. And then we walk out in a millennium. Same writer now. This first stage, he was innocent. And second, now if you went a little bit higher, a little more than that, the second stage, the Bible said he'd be given a crown, and they crowned a man, a superman, see? Crowned him, and then the Bible didn't call him a pope. The Bible called him a false prophet. Why? Yeah, of course,
he was be a false prophet by his Antichrist spirit that taught Antichrist against the original word. Because if he taught against the original word, it was Antichrist, and the word is God. See, Christ. Now, after that, we find him then crowned. When he got crowned, now he's very innocent and helpless. He's just a little fella. But then in the Nicaea Council, he was made it, and Constantine gave him all the property. And then what did he do? Then he, see, Satan gave him his throne and authority. The Bible said so, as we went through it. Now, the next thing we find out, that the devil controls all politics that ever has been or ever will be.
Amen.
We find that in Matthew 4:11. And now, we find out then that Satan already had politics, but he's trying to get the church. So he goes down to the sea pit, he gets his Superman, works him into an organization, and crowns him vicar.
Amen.
See? A Christ.
Amen.
Christ acted instead of God.
Amen.
See, this guy's a vicar instead of God. See?
Yeah.
It's the same, instead of God, what he's supposed to be, a vicar under Christ. Now, when he did that, then what did he do then? Satan took his political power, which he was already over, and took the religious power, which he had already been crowned, and put them together, and then he made him another crown over hell, and then it had passed on to pay enough money to get them out.
Yeah.
Okay? So now he's back for over heaven, over purgatory, as he wants to call it, no such thing in the Bible, see? But he had to make something.
The Bible said he come out of the bottomless pit and returns back the same way. And on earth,
the ruler.
Now, what was he given then? First, he had a bow, but he didn't have any arrow. But now he's got a mighty sword in his hand. He can do something now. Then he jumps off his white horse. The white horse rides on out. Now he straddles what? A red horse.
Blood.
Blood red horse. He really rides that one. Oh, sure. Now he's given great power and a great sword to kill.
Then he rides his blood-red horse. We see from the second seal that was broke last night, he taken peace from the earth and did kill one another. And his own martyrology of the Roman Catholic Church shows that they put 68 million Protestants to death from the time of St. Hippo, after St. Augustine of Hippo, until 1580-something. 68 million! Smucker's Great Reform, if you want to read it. Glorious Reform. Right? 68 million recorded on the martyrology when one of their so-called saints got the revelation that anybody that disagreed with the Roman Church should die as a heretic. That just set him around. Then, boy, he went to spilling the blood. He jumped on his white horse, on his red horse, and he went to ride. Oh, now his great power comes. He was made vicar of heaven and worshipped as God. Ruler of the earth by uniting the church and state together, made him ruler on earth, gave him a crown over that. He could pray the souls out of purgatory. He could he was just like God on earth instead of God. Together, he had great power to kill whomever did not agree with his command. Who's going to say anything to him? Church can't say nothing. He's head of it. State case then, he's head of it. So they died by the millions. All them little churches, brother, was busted up and killed and murdered and fed to lions and everything else. See? The dragon, Rome, gave him his seat and authority. The Bible said so. So he rode his tight red horse through human blood to become a red horse. Now John sees him on a black horse. He's changed something else. I have to say this just the way it comes to me.
Amen.
And then, and if it come to me and didn't compare with the rest of scriptures, then God never give it.
Amen.
See, the scriptures has to, every one, it's just one great big thing like that.
Amen.
Scripture has to agree with scripture. And anything's contrary to the scripture, if that angel of the Lord told me anything it wasn't scriptural, I wouldn't believe him.
Amen.
I said there in Chicago today with all them hundreds of ministers. Was anybody there at that meeting? Sure, that meeting in Chicago. I said, now you all talk about you thought just twisting in here or something. About like it's in this room now. I said, what is it? You got it against me. I said, the Holy Spirit showed me 3 nights ago where every one of you'd be, and we wouldn't be in that. I asked Carl here if this right, and there was Hank and all of them. That's right. You always are here. Yeah. I said, now you got it against me on my teaching. That's what's the matter. Now I want one of you to come here and get your Bible and stand by me and disprove it. It's the quietest bunch you ever heard. I said, what's the matter with you? I said, then if you know you can't stand up against the Word, then get off of my back.
Amen.
You doctors of divinity and everything and talking how to introduce yourself as doctor, doctor, doctor. I'm a... Brother Woodson, I say cheechock or greenhorn. I have no education, never come through any seminary or school, but you get your Bible and come here and stand by my side. Disprove the serpent seed, the baptism in Jesus' name, or any of those things out there. Nobody said a word, you only. That's the quietest bunch you ever seen. See, they just crow like, I don't know what. Now here it is. I don't believe in fussing with people, but when it comes to a spot where they try to drag you into it, and I wouldn't have went, but the Holy Spirit told me, said, go on over there, I'll stand by you.
Amen.
Told them 3 or 4 days before time. You all was there and heard Mr. Carlson and them and Tommy Hicks and all of them sat there, and I went 3 days before, and I said, you're going to have to cancel that place. It's a stormy night. I was having a meeting. He said, go stand at that window at that third little door there, and I went there and stood right in there. I looked out like that. He said, they got a trap set for you. They're going to ask you to speak at that Ministerial Association of the Greater Chicago. He said, they got a trap set for you on your teaching of my word. He said, now they're going to cancel off that place. Well, they ain't going to get it. They're going to get to a place where it's found. I said, here it looks. I stopped and I see myself in the corner. Look back there and I seen all them different. I seen all them ministers sitting there the way they was. I looked them all over and he said, well, I thought I better not go over there then, Lord. If they're going to do that, I don't want to hurt their feelings or do anything wrong. He said, go. I'll stand by you. He did. That's right. Now, you all just witnesses right here. We're sitting right there. No, that's true. That's right. Well, you got the tape, sure, also. But there you are, you see. Now, here is the mystery of this. And now, when it revealed to me early this morning before daylight, then I went quickly to the scripture and began to look, search it up. There it was. Three of them so far has been absolutely supernaturally revealed.
Amen.
Now here is the mystery of the black horse according to what was revealed to me. He has started riding him in the time of the dark ages. That's what the dark horse represented. The dark ages, for it was a time of midnight to the true believers.
Amen.
That was left. Watch now, and that church age, that middle church age, the dark church age, watch how it says you just have a little strength.
Yeah.
It's a midnight to them for the true believer. Now, watch. Practically all hope had been taken from the true church. For this fellow controlled both church and state. What are they going to do? See, Catholicism had taken over both church and state. And all who didn't agree with Catholicism was killed.
Amen.
That's reading is on a dark horse. Watch what a dark thing he done. See, and then you see, and you know your history. Watch it, and you won't have to even know it to know this. Now what? All hope was gone. That's his black horse. Now he rode in on his white horse, cunning. Then he's give power. He took peace, slaughtered the millions. That's what he was going to do. As he rode on through, and he still does it. See, now here he is on his black horse. Now coming forth. Dark age, that was that time, just about the time after the church got set up and gotten power, they smothered out everything else and went through about a
Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years is what every reader knows as the Dark Ages. How many knows that?
Amen.
The Dark Ages. There's your dark horse.
Amen.
Representing that dark age. Now, all hope's gone. No hope at all. Everything looked dark for the little believers. Now, that's the reason it's represented a dark horse. His balances are his scales in his hand. You see, calling out measure of wheat for a penny and three measures of barley for a penny. See? Actually, that is wheat and barley is natural staff of life. That's what bread and stuff's made from. But you see, he was charging for this.
Sure.
Yeah.
What it means that he was charging his subjects for the kind of the hope of life that he was sending out to them by making, he started in that very time of making them pay for prayers.
Amen.
Charging for prayer. They still do it. No venience. Because what was he doing? Capturing the wealth of the world.
Amen.
The scale weighing out measure of wheat for a penny, three measures of barley for a penny, the rider on a black horse. See? He was making, stripping his subjects of their money.
Amen.
When the Bible predicts that he holds about the wealth of the world, as we said last night about Russia and all that, they just take all the money, just strip the people for everything they got. So there you are. Now, notice, you see where that old money taken in church comes from?
Amen.
Get away from this stuff. To build an organization, a big something, $1 million a year. You see what the mother of it is?
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Oh my. I'm so glad. Yes, sir. All right. It's been His grace. That's all. All right. All right. It's a midnight time. Do you understand that now?
Amen.
And here He is charging for the kind of life, that's this barley and stuff, natural. Wasn't spiritual now. It was barley. So, and barley bread and wheat bread. He was charging for that kind of a life that he was giving to his subjects, charging for prayer by the priest to pray people out of purgatory, charging, I'm taking this right out of history, charging for, I guess it's novenia, I guess what everybody knows what, novenia, I guess that's something you have to do, you know, some penance, somebody has to charge for that. Bringing the wealth of the world to him, into himself, into the church itself, and he's still riding.
Amen.
Oh, he sure is. Yes, sir. Still riding. Notice, here's the good part now. Notice, see that thou hurt not this wine oil. Just a little bit of it left, Brother. Don't you touch that. Now, oil is symbolizes the Spirit, the Holy Spirit. I'll give you a few verses if you want to, or two scriptures in Leviticus 8:12, where Aaron before he went had been anointed with oil, you know, and Zechariah 4:12, the oil coming pouring through the pipes and said, this is my Spirit, oil. And another thing, if you want to see Matthew 14:25, there was a foolish virgin, 25:3, the foolish virgin had no oil, no Spirit. And Matthew 25:4, the wise virgin had oil in her lamp. Spirit filled. Spirit, oil typifies the Spirit. Oh, Lord. You get it?
Amen.
All right. Now, oil typifies Spirit, and wine symbolizes stimulation of revelation. I like to run all over the place. Wonder did it wake up the neighborhood and the Lord showed me that? Stimulation of revelation. See? Oil and wine in the Bible is associated together. Always. I got the Concordance, look, the string of that like that where wine and oil goes together all the time. See? When the truth of a promised Word of God has been truly revealed to his saints that's filled with oil, they all get stimulated. Oil is a stimulation.
Amen.
Glory, I feel it right now. Stimulated with joy, shouts. And when it does, it has the same effect upon them that wine does upon a natural man. Because when the revelation has been given of a truth of God, and the true believer filled with oil, and the revelation is revealed, the stimulation becomes so great that he makes him behave himself unnormally. Right. That's what's the matter with him now. Right. Makes him behave or act unseemingly.
Hallelujah.
Now, if you want scripture for this, just start reading Acts 2.
Amen.
What had? They had the promise that had been given them.
Glory.
When all of the promise of the Holy Spirit was poured out on them and was it was scripturally vindicated. Now, I see that. What if he said, now wait, he told us to wait up here for our ministry. And after 8 days, it said, well, I tell you, boys, Mark said to Matthew, I believe we've already got it, fellas. Don't you think so? See, we already got it. While we're waiting on our ministry, and all, we are drawing out preaching. He told us to come up here and wait. This is 8 days we've been here. Well, let's wait another one. 9 days come. Then Mark comes around, or maybe one of the rest of them, John said, I believe you aren't waiting any longer. I believe you've already got it, don't you? And I can see Simon, because he had the keys, you know.
Amen.
Wait a minute, boys.
Amen.
The scripture's got something to say about this. He never told us just how many days to wait. He said, you stay there until.
Amen.
You stay there until Joel's prophecy comes to pass.
Amen.
Until Isaiah's prophecy is vindicated. For with stammering lips and with other tongues will I speak to this people. And this is the refreshment. This is the wine that's poured out. What is wine in the Bible? Refreshments. This is the refreshment that comes from the presence of the Lord. It's got to be scriptural now, see? So you see, wine represents stimulation of revelation. And when the Holy Ghost fell and they seen the fire of God fall upon them, my, that began to stimulate them. And the first thing you know, they got so stimulated till the people actually thought they were drunk. But they were stimulated by the revelation. God, here it is, God's vindicated revelation made plain to them. They was happy about it. God promised it. Here it was revealed to them and vindicated to them. Here was the man standing there saying, this is that. This is it. And there it was being vindicated by the same sign. There's stimulation by revelation.
Amen.
And now they really had it then. That's the reason Peter could get out there and say, why, you man of Judea and you that dwell in Jerusalem, listen to me. All you doctors of divinity, listen to what I'm going to tell you. Oh, how wonderful. Revealed. They become so stimulated when they've seen it vindicated. That this always does that. It always does.
When
I see that God promised to do a certain thing in this day, when he promised to break off these seals in this last day, and you don't know the joy, the glory.
Hallelujah.
When I seen him reveal this, stand there and watch it happen.
Amen.
And know that I'll take any person to charge. He never did say one thing to us but what happened that way.
Amen.
And then to see the joy
It's in my heart when I see His promise for this last day as He promised to do it. And here I see it vindicated and made perfectly right. You hear me say I feel religious. That's what's the matter. The stimulation is so bad I just about ready to go to cutting up. You know. Stimulation from revelation. All right. They become so stimulated over the revelation.
Amen.
That they vindicate. All right, the promise. Oh, my. There broke out the joy of stimulation till the people said they're drunk on new wine. When God revealed His promise to them. And not only did He reveal it, but He proved it. That's what I've always said. A man can say anything. He could just have to say anything. But when God comes around and vindicates that. Now the Bible said, if there be one among you who claims to be spiritual or prophet, if he says these things and it don't come to pass, then don't pay no attention to him. Don't fear him at all. Don't fear that man. But if he says it and it comes to pass, that's me, he said. I'm in that. That proves why it's me. And then that little Samaritan woman, when the scripture said that this Messiah would do these things, and here he stood and did it just exactly what the scripture said, she said, there he is. Come see a man. Isn't that exactly the thing that the scripture said would happen? See? She got stimulated by revelation. Is that right? She becomes stimulated by revelation when it was vindicated. See? That's right. She knowed that we know that Messiah is a coming, who's called the Christ. And when He comes, He will do these things. She's seen it. And He said, I'm He. Then the stimulation started. And away she went. Shouting and down through the city, she left her old water pot and went down there and said to the man, come and see. If you only know the Eastern traditions, that's wrong for her to do that. Yes, sir. A woman of that type, nobody listened to her. No, sir. See, she had a mark. And when she would go down the street like that and act like that, the man in the street paying attention to her, brother. She had a word of life there. She was stimulated. You know, like
hallelujah.
Trying to put a house out on fire on a windy day. Oh, there's something fanning. She was ready. Yes, he couldn't put that out. That was God's fire burning. She said, if you don't believe it so, you just come over here where the meeting's going on. I'm not sure. Yes, sir. And so the man went out there, and he didn't do it one more time, but they knowed something happened to that woman. She was changed, so they believed him. Yes, sir. They believed on him. Because faith cometh by hearing the promise of God, the Word of God, and watching it being made real. Because it's a seed, and when it's sowed, it'll take life. It'll produce just what it's talking about. If it doesn't, then it isn't got seed.
Praise the name of all.
Or the sower didn't know how to sow it. He wasn't the saint of God to sow seeds. He might be sowing them on top of a rock or something. So you see, the sower, sowing the seed, God takes care of it. It falls in the right place. Oh, my. Then, what does it say to this rider in black? Don't you hurt my wine and my oil. Don't you touch it. My wine oil. I've got just a little bit of it down there, but there's still a little bit there. Yeah. Now, you can go on through and measure out all that kind of life that you're putting out. That's up to you. You're going to pay for it down there. But when you come across that wine and oil, you leave it alone. Oh, my. If you catch some of my little flock that's filled with my oil and wine, see, wine and oil of the pure word, see? And you're going to kill them, because you're doing it, that's what you're doing. Don't you force them to say any Hail Mary or do anything like that or some of your creeds.
Amen.
You keep your hands off of them, they know where they're going. Or they are anointed with my oil. And by being anointed with my oil, they have the wine of joy because they know my word of promise. I'm going to raise them up again. that. Don't go try to mess them up, because just keep away from them.
Amen.
Oh. Oh, he vindicates his word and brings it in. They knowed. They knew they'd rise again. Oh, how I like that. Whew. They'll rise again.
Amen.
Here comes a black horse riding now. Dark ages. That went the white horse. We've seen what he done perfectly. Here comes a red horse. We see exactly what he done. Here comes a black horse. You see the same rider all the time. What he's doing right down through the ages. Now, we find out he measured it out and charged for it. Exactly. Wheat. Natural life. It's what he's living on. But symbolizing spirit, oil, and joy of the wine. That's spiritual life. Don't hurt that. Leave it alone. But otherwise, Rome, don't you touch it. It's mine.
Amen.
Amen.
That belongs to me. Now, we've got another thing here I want you to notice. Notice, it was not one of the four beasts that said, don't touch the oil and the wine. Did you notice that?
Amen.
The four beasts have been talking. But watch. Let me just read out here just a little bit. See? Now, measure a penny for wheat for a penny and three measures of barley for a penny, and see that thou hurt not the wine nor oil. Now listen here. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts.
Amen.
What was it?
Glory.
The Lamb.
Amen.
Was the four beasts? The Lamb said it.
Amen.
Wow. Don't take his own. That belongs to him.
He's amen. Amen.
Amen. Don't you touch that oil. Now, sir. Not the four beasts, but the Lamb was the one that said it. Oh, my.
Amen.
The Lamb, not the four beasts that announced this. The Lamb said itself, when the four beasts said, come and see. And they went and seen it like that. He said, a measure of wheat for a penny and a four may and so much like this and so much barley. But then the Lamb cried out right among them and said, but don't hurt the wine and oil.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Oh, my. Listen to it. Don't you hurt it, or you're going to pay for it someday. Oh, my. 9:30. Well, to the best of my understanding, and the best that I know of, and with all that I believe in my heart, that's the true meaning of those three seals.
Amen.
I want to thank God for it.
Amen.
And I'll say this, that it's a revelation that He gave me. He gave that to me, the revelation of it. And I do believe that we're living in the last days.
Amen.
Tomorrow night we'll take that pale horse rider. And now, I do not know, God knows, that's true, I do not know one thing about it. No. I looked up my old context I had years ago. I seen Brother Grim Snelling a while ago, he might have went out. But I remember when I was preaching here before, I looked up to see what I said years ago. One day I was going through the book of Revelations, I took all four horse riders one time. I said, a white horse, that was the early church, no doubt. I read that out of the book of the Adventists, and I read something else. I said, that was the early church that went forth conquering. And the next was a black horse. I said, I forget now what I call that black horse. I said, or the red horse, rather. I said, that horse is probably mean that trouble is on the road, and it's going to mean a lot of war is going to hang up, or something like that. I said, probably there'd be a lot of war. I said, that's what they'd be. And then I said, the black horse, I said, that means that maybe there'll come a black time on earth when all the stars will quit shining, the sun will go down, and moon won't give its light. I said, that's probably what that means. I said, the pale horse, it means a lot of sickness is coming on. I don't know what it means, but that's my interpretation of it then, because I just took it the best I could, staying here in the pulpit. But, oh, I almost said something. All right.
Hallelujah.
Oh, you'll see. We're watching. Now,
glory.
Oh, aren't we happy for this hour? And we see all this thing heading up. I think nations are breaking. Israel's awakening.
the signs that the prophets foretold, the Gentile days numbered with sorrows encumbered, return, O dispersed, to your own. The day of redemption is near. Man's hearts are failing for fear. Be filled with the Spirit, your lamps trimmed and clear. Look up, your redemption is near.
Oh, Mary. False prophets are lying. God's truth they're denying, that Jesus the Christ is our God. You get it?
Amen.
But we'll walk where the apostles have trod. For the day of redemption is near. Man's heart are fading for fear. Be filled with the Spirit. Have your lamps trimmed and clear. Look up, your redemption is near.
Isn't that wonderful?
I love that.
Hallelujah.
Redemption is near. And it shall be light in the evening time. The path to glory you will surely find. In the waterway is a light today, buried in the precious name of Jesus. Young and old, repent of all your sin. The Holy Ghost will surely enter in. The evening light has come. It is a fact that God and Christ are one.
He's the Word.
Wonderful. Soon the Lamb will take his bride to be ever at his side. All the host of heaven will assemble me. Oh, it will be a glorious sight. All the saints in spotless white. And with Jesus they shall feast eternally. Oh, come and die. Master crawling, come and die. For you may feast at Jesus' table all the time. Hey, the kingdom of the Jew, turn your honor into wine. To the hungry call of now, come and die.
Oh, come and
die. Master crawling, come and die.
Dine on the Word.
You may feast at Jesus' table.
Stand down and raise up our hands and express ourselves to him. I love him. I love him because he first loved me.
Hallelujah.
All right, all together now.
Deal Reverend, we have an interpreter here, Brother Higginbottom. I don't know if he's here tonight or not. We'll find out what he said to us. Just wait a minute. Up high in God. You love Him tonight with all your heart? Oh, praise Him. Say thank you, Lord. How we give you praise with all of our hearts, Lord. Glory to God. Just give Him praise, all you. God, keep it.
Remember baptismal services tomorrow night at 6:30, possibly a few minutes before that.